appreciate it. I know Greg was really keen to get you here.
Yeah.
And I think he's in a meeting at the moment, isn't he?
Yeah, thanks for having me. And yeah, this is a little bit rushed just because work's been busy, but feel free to just interrupt me and ask any questions. But what I was sort of planning was just talking through my experiences, what I did through university to get to where I am now. So that involved pretty much, so I started at Massey University in Palmerston North, and I was doing a Bachelor of Science in Physics and Sports Science, and I was rowing at the time. So I sort of had a few opportunities with rowing, which made me move down to Dunedin. So then I carried on studying down there, which made it a little bit tricky because the sports science degree in Dunedin, as you know, is its own separate thing. It doesn't come under the sciences, and I didn't want to go back to the start and have to do dance, pretty much. So I sort of kept doing all the science papers and got rid of dance and gym. But then I finished a PGD and then also did a master's at the end of that. So yeah, so Bachelor of Science in Physics and then a PGD and then a master's. As I was doing my master's, I started volunteering with different sports around the area, and I did that through the, at the time it was like the sports, regional sports trust run by a guy, Dean Horrock, and he just got me involved with sort of local athletes who were sort of part of the programs. I do sort of different works with them, testing, performance analysis, just whatever needed, just to pretty much get experience myself and also just get my name known around the area.
Did you look for those experiences, Justin? Or
I did.
I actually went out.
So that's, I guess it's one thing that I wanted to sort of stress in this thing, like there's not that many jobs out there in the performance, sports science performance area, so you've really got to sort of do that little extra bit to get out there. So yeah, I just went and asked around, said, do you need any help, can I can do this, and it was all just, yeah, in my own time, off my own back. But it led into an awesome opportunity with Cycling New Zealand. So leading into the London Olympics, they actually needed someone to help with just videoing training sessions. So I went down to Chicago and spent time down there, just watching them go around and around. And they liked what I did, and I sort of just tried to go a bit beyond what they were asking me to do. And I was lucky enough that they put a PM scholarship in for me, which allowed me to travel away with the team in the lead up to London Olympics. So it wasn't paid, they just paid for my flights and food and accommodation, but it was a good experience. And then following that, following the London Olympics, they offered me a full-time role with a as a performance scientist, working with the men's and women's physiology team, like for the team pursuits as a woman and men's physiologist. Yeah, so
still based down south, or were you moved up here?
South at that time, so I was based in Dunedin still, and moved up to Cambridge when they built the velodrome. So yeah, so that was all pretty good. And then following Rio, Rowing New Zealand advertised for a job for a performance scientist, and because rowing used to be my sport, I was quite keen to sort of move back to it, and also just it was a good opportunity to learn more and sort of develop, because yeah, which I'll sort of talk a bit more about going forward as well. Because so my role at Cycling New Zealand sort of changed quite a lot over the 4 years that I was there. So I started off just doing performance analysis, so I was looking at what other teams were doing on the track, what our team was doing. So one of this graph here sort of shows one of our team pursuits. And like, as you sort of seen in a lot of physiology studies, and that like pacing strategies and like the optimal pacing strategy is an even pace. That's not an even pace. That's actually showing that they've gone out way too hard at the start and then they've blown up. So a lot of it would be coding video to sort of give feedback to the coaches on what athletes were doing, what, how it was affecting people. So we can sort of see here, like they started really well, gone slightly over the pace. Second rider's done all right, but the third rider has just bombed pretty much. And then she's tried to stay on for an extra half lap, which has been cost to other teams because they, other riders, because they've been able to accelerate. And to accelerate takes a lot more power than just holding a steady pace. So we'd sort of give this information back to the coaches to help them with their decisions. So I guess that's probably our big thing, is the performance scientist that's working with the coaches to provide them evidence and information and support them in their decisions. And then I guess it was one of the big things that I learned as I came into cycling from university, was it's not as simple as doing an experiment in the lab. There's a lot of other things going on, because I just sort of thought we'd come in, we'd test people, and we'd give individual training programs for everyone, and if we wanted to try something else, we had this awesome group that we could try stuff with. But there's so many more demands on it. There's, because you've got competitions, you need to get the buy-in from coaches, because it's coach-led, athlete-focused, and then sort of data-driven, that you can't sort of just try new things without having that buy-in from the coach, because the athletes are the ones who suffer or benefit from it, and it's their livelihoods. So it'd be really cool to try some stuff, but if it's high risk, then you need to do a really good job of selling it. So you need to sort of do your background and try to find, and that's where I think relationships with like universities, WinTech, all that sort of thing's really good, because we can get you guys to do little pilot studies for us and see if things work before we try it on our elite athletes. Yeah. So that was what I sort of started off doing, and then I sort of moved more into physiology support with, especially with the women's team pursuit. So that's when it changed from 3 riders at London into 4 riders going into Rio. And we had a squad of about 6 riders. So we do a lot of athlete monitoring and tracking. And the predominant training mode they use is road riding. So we don't actually do that much work on the track. So we would look at, okay, have you guys seen this sort of graph before? Sorry, the contrast is a bit. Okay. This is from WKO, or Training Peaks. So it's just showing longitudinally what acute training load, chronic training load, TSS, all those sort of information. So we use that to sort of look at the progression that athletes are going through and feed that back to the coaches to say, well, hey, this person's probably getting close to just getting pushed over the edge, but you're increasing the risk of injury, and back off a little bit, or this person actually hasn't really moved on, and we need to increase the load a little bit so that we're getting that stimulus to get the adaptation that we want. And then we'd also be looking at power, because on the track, TSS actually doesn't work at all, because all the efforts are so short. So we'd look at MMP, maximal powers, and we'd be looking at powers from 1 second up to 4 minutes on the track, and we'd sort of be trying to progress those. So it's all sort of just benchmarks to look at and sort of to inform, help the coaches inform their training programs, give feedback to the athletes on how they're progressing, what their weaknesses are, and why we're sort of going to work on certain things. We also do warm-up cool-down protocols, and that's when we actually do get to do what we practiced at university. So we do lactate tests and some VO2 work, and sort of work out what the best individual warm-up for an athlete is to prime their aerobic system and get them in the best state for competing. Because like for team pursuit, it's a 4-minute event, and the track's actually really easy because it's so controlled, so we know pretty much when everyone's going to be racing. So you can work backwards and get everything dialed right in, to from bicarb loading to doing some plyometrics and things before. Like, so what we would sort of do is the athletes would do like some plyometric sort of priming in the morning, do a sort of aerobic ride, have a few hours off, come in, do another warm-up where they do a sort of VO2 type effort to get the aerobic system prime, and they have about 10-15 minutes just flopping around, and then they get on the track and race, and we're trying to get them pretty much so that when they're on the start line, they're ready to go, their best ability. And yeah, so with cycling it's really easy too, because you've got so much information there available, like power meters, heart rate, everything, and it's in a nice controlled environment. And then I also ended up like training session support, so because I think this is another point that I wanted to sort of just talk about, was in working in a high performance environment, even though your role is like a performance scientist, you end up doing everything. So you'd end up like counting laps, holding riders. It actually ended up at the end of my time with Cycling New Zealand, I ended up coaching the development girls and the senior girls for a while. So I ended up taking them to competition. So it's just always been willing to actually just put your hand up and help and do things. It's just good practice and it does help you out. This is one of the cool things that I actually really enjoyed with cycling, and it sort of brought into play my physics. So we were really lucky with cycling. We have a group of engineers based up at Auckland called the Goldmine Team. Not sure if you've ever heard of it. Yeah. So all our bikes were like fully instrumented. So we pretty much, we had high resolution data on everything like speed, power, cadence, all those sort of easy ones, but also like what the riders are actually doing on the bike in terms of like wobbling side to side. And from that, we were actually able to do some simple modeling to start with. So again, because everything was nicely controlled, we could work out from the force, like everyone knows a little bit of physics and what that equation sort of says. Yeah, so we were able to work out what their drag was. And because we sort of knew their drag, we could then work out what power they needed to do to go certain speeds. And we know, because it's a controlled environment, you know what you need to do to win at the Olympics, because pretty much the time has been getting faster every Olympics. So we knew to medal we had to achieve that. And we could then give the athletes, like when you were on the front of the team pursuit, you need to be, for the girls it was 420 watts they needed to be able to hold on average. Like each of the riders is slightly different, because some are bigger, some are smaller. So that was our sort of goal to what we wanted to get to. So then we had an end point, we could then work with the coaches and try to get our athletes to that point.
So cool.
Yeah. It didn't quite work because obviously we didn't win a medal because other teams just went faster. But yeah, like we're using the science to help the athletes and actually inform coaching and training decisions. So then I moved on to Ride New Zealand after Rio, and it was just because I wanted to change and sort of develop a bit more myself. And at rowing is a different environment. Like it's one of New Zealand's most successful sports, and the squad is huge. Like at the moment we have 42 elite athletes training out of Karapiro. We have 30 under 23s, and we have about 20 or so juniors arriving in the next few weeks. And the building's not a big building, and there's actually only 3 performance scientists for all those numbers, and we have 3 SMCs. Where at cycling, we actually had a performance scientist for each group, which was only 10 athletes. So there's a lot more to do. And in terms of monitoring, we do a similar thing as we did for cycling. We monitor load and feedback to the coaches on how athletes are adapting and handling training, because we want to be able to get everyone training consistently in the right intensity so that they get the most out of everything. Because, and it's been research shown that like, if you complete at least 90% of all your prescribed sessions, you're going to, your chances of winning at the Olympics or your pinnacle event increases quite a bit. So we're trying to keep all our athletes as healthy and fit as we can. But it is really hard with elite athletes because we're actually not healthy people because they're pushing themselves hard so much of the time. Yeah. So yeah, so we use heart rate at the moment and look at TSS. Reason we do that is because we actually, it's the only way we can do it. We do use RPE and well-being as well, which sort of gives you a bit outside of the picture. But it's a lot harder in rowing compared to cycling because we don't have power measures and there's so many different things going on in the boat because of the environmental conditions. It makes it a lot harder. But yeah. And then we also do lactates, we do on water checks because the athletes will be rowing along at a certain heart rate and we hike that there like in the aerobic extensive sort of training zone. So then we'll just quickly stop the boat, go in the coach boat, take some lactate from the air, go off and they'll carry on and we try to monitor that way. Again, we do warm up and cool down protocols based on the individual crews. So small boats are a lot easier because they don't need as much water to actually get sort of time to warm up in the correct zone. Like 3 minutes for a double, they'll only sort of go just short of 1,000 meters, but an eight is almost going 1,000 meters. So you sort of need to factor those things in. So then, so we sort of individualise it so that the eight, rub the girls and the guys in the eight probably do a warm up on the ergs and then jump into the boat where the smaller boats can do all their warm ups on the water, which is the ideal situation because it's specific to the sport. My other roles at Rowing New Zealand is sort of technical analysis, so we do some biomechanics work. So we have a system called Peach, which we put onto the boat and it sort of measures the forces and the angles that all the, that each individual athlete is doing, and then we can look at the timing and sort of answer the question that the coaches ask. That's quite a time sapping thing because setting up and then just monitoring things. And you also, you collect the data from the session, then you have to process it, and then you feed it back, where our athletes are sort of training 3 times a day sometimes. You're trying to get that quick turnaround so that they actually, so that it's relevant. So it's, yeah, it's quite a hard one, but yeah. And then also heat acclimation. So last year, the world champs were in Florida, and they were quite late in the year, so it was still quite warm over there. So, and we came back from Europe and trained in New Zealand, where it was winter. So we're trying to get our athletes ready for the heat. But obviously we're training on the water, so you can't just have them training in the heat chamber, especially because, like I said, we've got sort of 50, nearly 50 athletes to cram all those into a heat chamber. It's not really very good. So we looked at like hot water immersion, heating up our gym for certain sessions, and trying to get the athletes to wear more clothes on the water. So I guess it's trying to take all the things that we learnt at university and through our studies and then apply it into the real world situation to work around training and what the sport needs. Yeah.
Do you find that it was hard when you told the rowers to put more clothes on the water because they knew that they could just take it off and be cooler?
Yeah, so a lot of what we have to do to like sort of as well as getting buy-in from the coaches is athlete education. So whenever we sort of try to bring something in, we always sort of give a presentation on why we're doing it so that the athletes understand. So trying to get them to wear more clothes was actually really tricky, especially surprisingly with girls because I just didn't want to. So you sort of end up being like, if you have some more clothes on, like you're going to stress your body a little bit more, it's going to help you adapt, so that when you get overseas, you're going to be able to perform at the best of your ability just because you're used to it. So yeah, a lot of it is sort of just education.
Yeah.
That's probably really quick, sorry.
That's all
right.
Questions.
I've just got one back with your athlete monitoring stuff. Like you say, it's really hard. You do all the well-being scores and stuff like that. Have you guys ever played around with heart rate variability, or does it do anything for you, or not really?
So before I started, so the physiologist at Rowan New Zealand was Dan Plews, and he did a lot on heart rate variability. And when I started, I actually asked the same question: what did you guys get out of it? Do you want to carry it on? But the sport didn't seem that interested in carrying it on. It is quite intensive, and yeah, I guess it's not in the area that I'm well sort of up to date in. So yeah, I'm not sure what they really did get out of it. Have you used a little bit of it, or?
No, I've just worked with people who have.
Yeah.
But like you, I don't know a lot about it. I just know it exists and it can do some stuff.
Yeah.
So I was just wondering if you guys had played around with it.
One of the things, like, I guess we'd never use just one thing in isolation.
Yeah.
So it's another tool that you can add
to
tie into your well-being, your loads monitoring, and all that sort of information.
Cool.
So I think, yeah, in isolation, it's probably really hard to read into it, but with other tools, I think it could be really useful.
Cool.
What's the most valuable measure for you, I guess, if looking at both spots you've worked in, and the cyclists, very data-driven, and they love what cycle, got a couple of data to a professional cyclist, and they love telling you, I rode at like 600 watts at the cafe or whatever, But what for you as the scientist, what do you get most out of, or what do you see as most valuable for the athlete?
Again, I wouldn't pick just one thing, because I think a combination of it works is really good. But I think, like, the load through TSS scores for us, because it's an endurance sport, most of our time is just steady state rowing. That does give us a really good indication of the load the athletes are going through, but I think that tied in what actual well-being is just from the athletes. Like, I think actually talking to your athletes and that, and getting their feeling, it gives you that other side of the picture. Because you're going to have an athlete who you'd be looking at the data, like for cycling, and you'd be like, oh, your power's going down, your training is all fine, like your times are good, your duration's good, but then you talk to the athlete and they're like, oh, I'm just not sleeping. And that's sort of something that you wouldn't get across just from that side of information. But together, I think it's really strong.
That's cool.
In terms of your work at Cycling New Zealand as well as rowing, how much of the information you collected did you have to communicate, or did you communicate with the strength and conditioning coaches as to when they went to the gym?
At cycling, it was quite a bit. Because, like, track cycling is quite, it relies on being strong. Like, so we're not just training road riders, so we do want strength because you need that power. And so this S&Cs we work with quite a lot, so they'd actually come watch track sessions, because then they could modify their training programs based on what we were doing. So there was a lot of communication that way, just because if you were doing a big block on a track, it's really hard to then go do a big session in the gym. So I guess communicating to each other what we're working on was really good, because then you could compliment each other.
Yeah.
Again, with rowing, because it's so aerobically driven, like, we are, most of the elite squads only have two, maybe three gym sessions a week, where they have like about 10 on water sessions. So that this gym there, I guess, always sort of has to just follow what's happening on the water.
I mentioned you were coming into a couple of my students this morning, who sadly have other classes. They're sort of second years, and it was in a biochemistry lecture, which they really enjoyed. How valuable do you think that sort of, I guess almost like classical science background or your physics background, like plays into what you do?
Quite a lot actually. I went through uni with quite a few other mates who, well, one of them is now sort of designing websites, one's a school teacher and that, because they couldn't sort of get into the area. And I think this, my background of actually doing sciences helps me quite a lot because it adds something else to my bow. But I also, I can understand a little bit more, I guess, why, I don't want to sound like I'm being cocky. It's helped me a lot, like with the cycling, like doing that modelling work and stuff like that, because I could relate that back to first principles of science. I was able to then link it into the physiology side of stuff, where if I hadn't have done that, it just would have been a lot harder to do. So I think it helped me understand, I guess, yeah, the underlying things behind everything, and it's also just made me think about things a bit different. And that's sort of like is what I noticed too, coming from university and rowing into cycling, like the sports and that are so different too. So actually just learning how to, I guess, look at things a little bit different and be adaptable rather than just being so set on what your experiences and thinking those are sort of it, just being open to change and
I've got a question, but I don't know if it's relevant. But if you, as a performance scientist, do you have any say on the, with the cycling, do you have any say on like the type of bike they use or like any alterations that they need to make or anything like that? Or does it make that much of a difference?
So it's still all like cycling and all high performance sports follow the model, like coach led athlete focus.
Yeah.
But when I was at cycling, I actually had another PM scholarship and actually went and did like a bike fit course and sort of used my biomechanics on that side of things. So then I started to do some bike fits with the younger athletes because we had like this guru who'd been doing it for years who'd come in and do our elite athletes. But it does play a big part, especially like the aerodynamic side of why of cycling. That's the biggest drag factor in there because you also like drive chain and the rolling resistance, but the aero drag is what has the biggest influence on how fast you're going. So if you can minimize that, it's awesome, but you can make someone really aero, but then they're not actually powerful in that position. So it's sort of trying to balance it. So you sort of see like track riders are in a really aggressive position. It's really aero, they can still put their power out, but they're only having to do it for 4 minutes. Where like a Ironman athlete, they're in a more aero position than like a road cyclist, but they're doing it for 3 and a bit hours. So it's sort of balancing up like the comfort versus power output in that. So it does have a huge part, but like my role, because we had a guru, he came and sort of did more of that side on the bike fit. But we did use that modelling stuff to look at bike designs and wheels and sort of be able to model it, because we knew this bike had a drag of this and this new bike has a lower drag, how much faster is that going to make you? And then we'll be able to calculate time savings. And that's, you would have probably seen in the news, we did like a big project with Southern Spas and they made the wheels for Rio for the pursuit team. Yeah, so usually they've been making masks and pieces of equipment for Team New Zealand, but they did a project with us, so we're able to actually look at the time savings that the wheels would help in terms of being lighter, and so that because they're lighter, you could accelerate them quicker because 4 seconds in mass times acceleration. But then you also, because they were lighter, you didn't have as much rotational inertia. So then I was sort of trying to balance that once you get up to speed. Because once the wheel's rolling, it keeps sort of rolling, ignoring like air resistance now. And then we did the same with like Avanti. So there is a lot of sort of collaboration between other organisations and sports to help get what you sort of, to help athletes. Because yeah, we don't have the resources and have to do things ourselves. And even expertise, like.
How much technology is in boats?
Not that much, actually. rowing is a very historic sport, so they haven't really changed the design in years. Some boats have started, like boat building companies have started to look at different things, but they're all sort of a composite build now. But that's sort of the main thing. No one's really done too much on oars design, like the blade design through the water. There was a point, I think in the 80s, where they changed the rigger. So a normal rowing boat, the athletes move up and down in the boat. So that's a lot of mass moving up and down. Where one of the boats in the 80s, they made the rigger move. So then the boat was moving underneath the athlete. So the boat only weighs for like a single, the minimum weight I think is 14 kilos compared to like Mahi, who's sort of 90.
Yeah.
It's a lot less mass moving, so it's a lot easier to maintain it.
Mm-hmm.
But then it got banned, so yeah, it's very historical, so there's a lot of rules, and it's like this is how rowing should be.
Do you find any of that permeates into what you do?
Oh, yeah, quite a lot actually. There's a lot of historical, like, this is the way we used to train, so this is why we train. Like, you can look at that, I imagine, in a lot of sports. Like, if you look down at a certain training session, like, or why do you do that session? It's like, oh, because my coach did it, and the coach did it before him. It's like, yeah, but why are you doing it? So there is a lot of sessions like that. Yeah.
Do you have to just accept those beliefs and look for it, or do you look for
I think
underneath it?
Yeah, I think like having those conversations with the coaches and sort of getting them to try to think about why and different ways to do things. Because if you're doing a session, like for example, like on the water, we do bungee sessions. So you tie a couple of bungees around the boat, and that stops the increases the resistance. So you don't get as much run between each stroke, but it also means that when you start rowing at full pressure, it's a lot heavier to pick up and you're more at risk of hurting yourself, like in your lower back, because that's going to be the weakest part in the chain. So I guess sort of communicating that with the coaches, but then there's a reason behind it. So they like to do that session because it teaches athletes how to get hold of the water, and you need that to be able to row well. And because everything's moving a little bit slower, you can start to get that feel. So I guess that's sort of a good conversation to have to understand why you're doing it, and knowing, okay, not all things are going to be physiological based. There's going to be technique sides to it, but also mental toughness sides to it. So, which is really big in rowing too. It's like we're going to row to Epworth and back, which is like 30 km. It's like, oh, be really tired, you probably could make that shorter. It's like, yeah, but I want to push you mentally. So that side of it, I think, is always good to be aware of. Like, there's going to be other reasons for sessions and training reasons, yeah.
When you're going away with teams, as a sports scientist, how has your role changed or not changed?
Oh, it changes quite a lot.
Yeah.
Like I was saying earlier, like you just end up having to do everything.
Yeah.
So I went away last year with the rowers to the World Cups. So we went to Poznan and Poland first, and then to Belgium, then to Henley, and then to Lucerne. And probably in terms of like actual physiology support, it was really small what I did. But I ended up like putting up a tent, setting up bikes so that they can warm down, getting ice, going to the supermarket to buy supplies and bananas for athletes, like, you just end up having to do a lot of things to help, and that's just part of it, but it's really cool because, yeah, you're doing a little bit to help the athletes actually achieve.
Should we call it that before I get onto the thermoregulation and the activation stuff, otherwise we'll be here all day?